Hi guys, welcome to my talk. Hope you're having a nice DrupalCon day one. I'm so excited to be at the DrupalCon Dublin speaking again. So this is my third talk in a row in this year. And before I start about me, now this is all about account management, customer success. So let's imagine, you are the customer, right? I'm the account. The outcome is probably the party after this. But let's take a quick show of hands and see how many people are what, and so that I could try to change the tone of my talk. So how many of us are from sales and revenue here? Sales, revenue, marketing together? Okay, that's like around about 50%, nice. How many do account management or are associated with account management? All right, the real guys for this session, it's okay. What about project managers? Cool, that's about you. Let's see who I am. My name is Piyush Podar. I'm the director of professional services at a company called Axelerant Technologies. And I'm also leading the account management practice over there. I've been a developer, architect, manager, been into various sales and marketing roles since 1997, and been an account manager on a lot of these instances. I've been Drupaling. I wouldn't say I've been coding in Drupal, but selling Drupal, promoting Drupal, and obviously speaking at Drupal events since last 8 years. I live in Jaipur, India, a nice tourist place to be in India if you've been for DrupalCon Asia this year. And you can reach me at twitter.com at / Piyush Poddar. Why account management? I actually wanted to start, my slide with the customary, what is account management, and a definition from Wikipedia, but probably then I dropped the idea. Let's get straight to the point. Why account management? And research shows that 70% of buying experiences are based on how the customer feels they are being treated. So, why we do account management? Why have we designed this strategic account management framework? These are the four key objectives or, activities or goals, I would say, in the same order that we have in mind when we work on our account management program. So we start with proactively identifying account risk to ensure that, which leads to the second point, which is reduce customer churn. So if you are able to identify those risks in time and address them, you would have more satisfied client and lesser churn rate. A lot of data points and practices from that I would be talking about in my session are mix of product and services together. So I try to blend them. Although we don't do a lot of products ourselves, we are more into services, delivering professional services. But this is. I did this intentionally to make sure that this gives value to a lot of people who are seeing the slides and attending this talk. And one disclaimer before I really get into this thing, I'm sorry to be pausing on this slide, is some of the practices that are there on these slides and I'll be talking about are not yet been deployed at Axelerant yet. So this is a constantly evolving process that we keep working on. So a lot of these things we already do, and some of these we have recently discovered. Partially also as part of working on this session, we discovered these from various resources, and then we said to ourselves, we should actually do these as well. We have had a good success rate from our previous clients and engagements based on the account management that we do. Having those extra elements or functionality, elements or checkpoints and activities and matrices, we feel that they'll really help us, scale to the next stage, and perhaps you guys as well. So I was at reduced customer churn. So if you have, customers being retained, customer retention is high, people are not leaving you, then that's when you can work to increase customer lifetime value. So this is Scouts, that's their logo, this is the client. This is what we've achieved after applying, a lot of these strategic account management practices that I'm gonna talk about. They started as a small tier customer in December 2015 and had a shared Drupal support to start with, right? First of all, what we need to do is we need to know our customer, right? More than just their projects. So, we need to know customer facts, policies which work there. So policies in terms of payments, policies in terms of annual budget planning, and you know, their structural organizational structural at the company, customers, their markets, and our business, and how do those two align their financial performances? Because end of the day, when you are going to segment these customers based on the few criteria I'm going to share, you'll need these data points. And once you are able to segment them properly in various tiers, then you could align the entire practice of account management and various activities based on those tiers. You don't want to spend a whole lot of time with people who are not, you know, paying or are not so valuable as opposed to the other ones who are like, who can really take you from, you know, stage A to stage B. And last is obviously their customer buying process. These are the three categories for these criteria. So a good balance between these three categories is important here. First is customer account based, which is sort of known known data points and known facts. They are based on outcomes that you, you know, based on business that you do with these customers. So like purchase margins, contributions, profit. These are things that you would know when you actually get into those accounts initially, and other facts about those company customers like turnover, growth in their market, etc. So these are, you know, one set of criteria. Another is customer need based. This is more qualitative and specific to and measurable. This will tell you the likelihood of your companies retaining their business. You know, things like global presence, dedication to compatible platforms, or are there challenges to compatibility that you feel you don't have a fit with, etc. And last is customer attribute based, which indicates future relationship with these accounts, with your company. These are like, you know, pretty softer criterias, other than the two other categories. And these are some of the factors that dictate how customer might behave, or decision making structure, you know, attitude towards partnership, how open are they to you know, getting into discussions like value-based selling and delivering and all that stuff, keenness to pay for value, which is the next point. Because if there's a fit not there, then, you know, you'll come across challenges. But then these may vary based on what you're selling, what your services are, and, you know, how do you want to grow together with those customers. So some of these criteria that we, you know, emphasize a lot on are contract value, ARR. ARR is actually, you know, for products, but revenue potential. You need to have some way of measuring or predicting, you know, what revenues are we looking at from this account for probably the next 2 to 3 years tenure. You know, anything for 6 months or 1 year is not good enough. And the brand value. So let's say if it's an IBM, you know, and the initial projects are small, you would still like that logo on your portfolio, your profile, to give you that value. And industry vertical as well. So, for example, if so this depends on what's your sweet spot. So let's say you have 90% of your customers are from technology, and if you get an opportunity to get into pharmaceutical or education, you know, you probably would like to win that account and you know, nurture them in thoroughly, because you want to move away from technology and you know, expand your space, de-risk yourself as well. So these are the five most important parameters that we have our side, and I'll show you how you can segment your customer accounts based on this these criteria. So we use a sheet something like this. You have those attractiveness criteria over there. You can apply, give relative importance weightage to each of these based on your industry, your business. And then you can have, you know, different customers, rate them on those numbers, see the total score, and then define you know, different level of tiers. Now you may have more tiers, you know, you may have 5 tiers or 1 tier or 2 tier, depending on, you know, how you operate your business. For us, you know, this is what works well. So any account from score of 850 to 1,000 is a strategic. So we call them strategic customers, and you know, we have more detailed way of handling those accounts with more senior and director level and VP level involved, which we'll see in the next few slides. I'll try to share some of these Excel sheets on the spreadsheets as well on the from my presentation. When we decided to move forward with this structure, we brought something called customer success management into the foray, which was not there. So earlier we only had, you know, regular account management and project managers and project deliveries and all that stuff. So we converted the project managers to customer success managers. And together, account management and customer success management, these two are the pillars for, you know, running the entire customer success program that we have at Axelerant. One of the questions that we had is, should we have the entire customer success under sales or under services or delivery? And then we decided that let's continue having both of them separate, but you know, there should be very close partnership level integration between these two departments. So account management is, you know, run by the account manager, subsequently a director of account management. We don't have a director of account management. I'm the guy who runs, you know, most of these two parts. But you know, once you scale, once you have like probably two or three or four account managers based on 20 or 25 accounts, then you can have a director of management, which is, you know, based on your needs. And then we have other professional services support, onboarding and training aspects as well. These are gonna be very important for onboarding customers and running the entire success program. Typically, this is a good, you know, designation or roles or people that you should need for this kind of a structure. Under account management, under your company, you know, the director of account management and account manager, customer success manager, director of customer success if you have, you know, a large number of success managers, and exec sponsors. So exec sponsors are nothing but, you know, typically CEO and COO and, you know, CFO or whoever. And not just the CEO, but all other C-level people and VP-level people can be involved with these accounts for check-ins and other, you know, strategic validation, which we'll see shortly. At the customer side, you know, we identify the customer decision maker and adoption champion. You know, this is the mid-level manager who's actually going to run that project, right? He's the guy who's your customer success manager who would be interacting on a regular basis. So we call him the adoption champion. And then, you know, they may have, you know, more people involved from their side. Let me take you through some of the artifacts that works well with this structure. So there's an account risk register. Now, because we have so many people involved, other than the account management, we need to see, you know, what are the risks involved. So there was a question about, you know, how proactively are we managing account management rather than being reactive at those instances or incidents. So, you know, we've defined these eight types of risks at Axelerant: readiness, process, delivery, quality, talent, company, sentiment, collection. So throughout my talk, whenever I mentioned company, that would be me, my company as Axelerant, and customer would be customer. So readiness is basically, you know, if the client is not yet ready for onboarding, meaning we haven't identified an adoption champion, or you know, there's a misfit yet. So, you know, more work needs to be done by the sales or maybe the account manager before the onboarding really starts, because onboarding is going to be a very crucial and critical, you know, process to build a foundation for the later success of the account. And the third row that you see there, director account management. So what we've done is, you know, we have owners. These are the senior people, right? The VP, C-level people. So these are the owners of these risk areas. So I know that if there's a, you know, there's a risk from sentiment perspective, which is basically a client is not happy, he's not, you know, filling up surveys, not responding to your emails and stuff like that. We have a sentiment risk on that particular account. And in that case, you know, this is the guy who needs to be informed and perhaps, you know, involved to de-risk that situation, because maybe the customer success manager is not able to get through to the customer. So, you know, the CFO of your company who, you know, knows the financial director of the customer well can actually call him and try to solve that matter. So these are various senior people at our company who are responsible for these risks in case the risks go anything green, right? So these are the three risks. You may have, you know, different risk levels. You may have more risks based on your business. Delivery is failure in on-time cost delivery. Quality is, you know, basically quality related. Talent goes to HR and, you know, director of engineering. At Axelerant, HR and engineering are very, entwined together. Company means changes at customer's company. So, you know, sponsor has changed, the financial difficulty has changed, you know, things have been hard on those fronts. So then the director account management needs to be invoked. Collections are again related to payments and invoices and even contractual to some extent. So we maintain this kind of a risk register, and in each of these check-ins, business review meetings, we share this data with the client as well, saying, hey, you see, I mean, this, in order to be transparent with them, we tell them that these are the risks that we had and, you know, how we have solved them and now we are all green. They may come up and say, hey, no, I mean, we are not still not happy. So, you know, there's a problem there. Then based on these risks, we create strategic account plan. Actually, strategic account planning starts, you know, at the very start when a customer is, you know, being onboarded. So based on their business challenges or requirements and things that needs to be done, we create a set of objectives for that particular account with tasks, divided by tasks, owners, and status. I mean, this is a standard practice that any company would be running anyways. But we've just given it a, you know, more shape. And these are related to both internal and external goals. So if we have internal goal that, you know, we need to sell more of support service to this client, we'll have a objective under, you know, scaling business with this, expanding business, and then we'll have set of tasks there. This is a representative a visual of this kind of account plan that we have. This is a very important document that we share with the client every time we get in a call with him. Not every time, sorry, not in the weekly or fortnightly check-ins, but the business reviews. So we this is what we show them. That, hey, these are the objectives together, your objectives, and, you know, objectives based on your requirements and our requirements, and this is what we've done or we are planning to do. This brings a whole lot of transparency and credibility and trust in the account relationship, because you're actually sharing your sort of playbook with the client, and, you know, they can add more stuff or, you know, ask you, you know, why are you having, you know, this discovery workshop. I mean, there's a disconnect, we don't need it at all, so don't you know, ping us all the time for this thing. And then we have account scorecard, which sort of shows you the summary of these, you know, these various artifacts, a summarized health view of the engagement. So anyone can see NPS, what's the current NPS score of this account, you know, how happy is the client, what's the total aggregate of the customer happiness index, the risk, the 8 risks, you know, where are we in terms of those 8 risks. This gives visibility to the stakeholders in company, the VP level people and exec sponsors at your side as well, and the client side as well. And often this is used when you go into those business review meetings, because you would need a lot of senior people at the client side, customer side, to be involved. And they don't want to go through, you know, long reports and all that stuff. They would only have 40 minutes or 60 minutes. So a snapshot of your overall health is what's important here. And, you know, these are indicators for risk status, as I said, customer survey scores, and other data points. These are the 4 life cycle for account management and delivery that we've identified. So new customer, onboarding, adoption, and advocacy. Adoption is the biggest one, where you are actually, the client has been onboarded, and now, you know, the entire 1 year period where you're interacting with him in, based on different cadence levels. We'll see each of these lifestyles, life cycle stages, and some of the activities that we do within these life cycle stages. So starting with new customer. So the sales handoff, you know, this is the first thing that happens. The sales hands over the account to the customer success team, which is the account manager, and the customer success manager, CSM. So, you know, things that we do, CRM updation, these are major things that we do. I mean, there are, you know, a few more minor stuff that we have from our side. So we update our CRM. There's an opportunity evaluation sheet, which was used by the sales team when they decided whether we want to, you know, go for this client or this account. So that data is being shared with the team, and all other contract documents, MSAs, SOWs, you know, any other document that needs to be, because the account management, the account manager is going to own all of those and run this, including success management and renewals. And then it's at this point, you know, we define who are going to be the account manager and customer success manager to this project. The participants of this meeting is sales and account management group. And this is like done once, because you only onboard a client once, hopefully. Then you have a kickoff meeting. So we have a fairly detailed, you know, set of data, information that we share with them. We introduce the company. We tell them, you know, what the partnership is about, you know, how we manage customer success and things that we do, the various engagement and communication processes that we have in channels, high level engagement schedule, which, you know, we'll see shortly, kickoff meeting being the first engagement activity with the customer, synopsis of tools and operational dynamics. So, you know, if this project is running a Scrum ban or Kanban or Scrum, what is that and how do we run that? Engagement, scope and delivery, assumptions and risks. A lot of these are standard kickoff requirements for project management, any typical project management practice. Account management and customer success team. So we introduce them to these two teams. Invoicing and collection schedules and seek business challenge index. So, you know, we created a list of a few business challenges just to help the customer to share with us what are the challenges that they feel they face and they want us to help them. So there was a question earlier, which was, you know, how do you help your customer define the requirements? So besides defining the requirements, we also want them to define challenges that they think we should be worried about. So we give them a set of around 20 challenges and say, I mean, do you have these challenges? Do you have these challenges? They can just take off and share these with us. Success plan creation initiated. So this is the first time when we are in a call with the client. So we initiate the creation of a success plan, you know, this document that I just showed you here. This is the account plan or success plan in SaaS companies. So we initiate that, you know, we take customers' inputs and later in probably the next call, we'll have the complete plan ready and we'll share that with the client and, you know, a few next steps. Participants are account manager, the lead of the account manager, management team, customer success manager, exec sponsor at the company. So we identify, you know, one exec sponsor for every account, depending on maybe a relationship with the owner of that company and, you know, one of the sponsors, one of the execs of my company, or based on a match of the industry, you know, some past experience, or perhaps availability as well. So this guy is going to be the exec sponsor throughout the account whenever, you know, shit hits the fan and the other people, the lower level managers are not able to fix it. And if things are going fine, you know, call the other person and do exec check-ins on a quarterly or monthly basis or annual as well. Customer participants are, you know, the product owner, if there is any, executive sponsor, adoption champion that I just mentioned there, so I actually missed mentioning it here. And typically video conferencing, because we have a majority of our team based in India, a remote team. So it's good to be in person, do these calls in person with clients, but, you know, probably the traveling of all of these logistics are going to be a little challenging. It works well for us from video conferencing perspective. So that's pretty much, you know, very simple 2-3 activities during kickoff, during a new customer. Now we are onboarding the client. Now, why we have defined this as a separate stage? Because, you know, we need to check the status of onboarding as well. And if things have not been done well, you can raise an alarm and be proactively trying to fix that. Technical onboarding is, you know, maybe for a support project, getting their code onto our systems, doing a code audit of the whole thing. So these are like delivery or engineering-based onboarding. Then we have account management-based onboarding, which is, you know, preparation of the strategic account plan that was initiated during the kickoff call, which has got goals and objectives of the customer, action plan for achieving each of these customer goals, and, you know, ideas to stop reacting and proactively manage the customer. So yeah, the account plan that I just showed you, the CSM, the customer success manager, send updates to all the parties involved at the end, along with a welcome kit. Welcome kit could help all of the data, all, you know, access details and the entire kickoff deck and everything else that needs to be shared with that client, including people that they can connect with and, you know, our set of practices. And technical onboarding is an internal activity. So, you know, our customer success manager will do that with the team, the delivery team. If it's a support project for professional services, you know, the support team would be there. If it's a professional services project delivery team, then, you know, there would be different engineer sets available involved. So that's basically onboarding, you know, just one activity, but a pretty major important activity. And once the customer is onboarded, now we are into adoption phase, also the engagement phase. So this is the entire duration of that account engagement after the onboarding till the renewal and, you know, the next phase and next phase onwards. So there are, you know, a couple of activities we do here under adoption. One is regular account review. So this is an internal activity we do with the team where we actually look at the account scorecard and customer adoption trend, you know, business challenges and risks, if they have been shared by the client and are we tracking them, what's the status, the strategic account plan review, customer happiness index report, and NPS report review. So these are, and the upcoming renewal and upselling opportunities. So this activity is important because to ensure that there is transparency between the customer success team and the account management team, right? So from delivery perspective, all data flows here, and from account management, all data flow here, based on this cadence. So for tier one, the strategic, we do a weekly account review. For tier two standard, we do fortnightly, and tier three small, we do monthly review. For tier three, it may not be, you know, both of them even getting together on a call. Just a quick review of the dashboards and these reports would suffice for them. In-person video conferencing, because even we are remote, so we don't have all of our people working in the same office. So we got online and we do this this call between the account manager, management team, and the customer success manager. Then after this, we'll do a check-in with the customer. You know, all of the things that we actually tracked in the previous thing, previous activity, we'll share with the client. We'll review the strategic account plan, the account scorecard. We'll share that with the customer, you know, give them updates. Business challenges and risks being tracked. We'll ask them if there are any new challenges now that they feel we should be worried about. Customer happiness index. So this is what you've told us about your happiness with us and how can we improve it. And upcoming renewal, upsell opportunities. And this is when the most active element of this meeting is the strategic account plan. So this is when we actually in the call decide that, okay, these are two new objectives or, you know, three new tasks that needs to be done, and we agree that, you know, we'll take care of them. So we add them to the account plan and we'll share them. This is just from the account management perspective. Obviously, you know, there's a whole lot of delivery-related updates and data points and discussions going on as separate. You know, my focus is primarily around how are the account management-based matrices and touch points being managed here. Participants are from the company side, account manager and CSM, from the customer side, another type of here. So secondly, this is the company side, the customer side, the adoption champion or the mid-level manager who's running their program, their engagement with us. And the frequency is pretty much similar. For strategic, we do a weekly call. With standard customers, we do a fortnightly, and with small, we do a monthly call. A lot of this, you know, practice and program is influenced by products and SaaS-based companies as well. So, but we feel that they work really well for us. So that's where you'll find a lot of similarity with the terminology and perhaps cadence as well. So that's a check-in with the customer. Then we do this exec business review where we introduce, you know, we do more introductions and company updates, recaps since the last EBR, company growth. So, we, you know, we tell them about us since the last 3 months, you know, this is what we've done new. Thought leadership, you know, these are the events that we participated in. These are the, you know, blogs, and these are the books that we probably written. We haven't written any book, by the way, at this point of time. Events, evangelize, you know, featured post, community contributions, etc. We do a lot of community contribution to Drupal ecosystem, so we share a snapshot of that data with them. Then we do an exec summary of the account during this review. So this is where the strategic account plan highlights are being shared. Health and adoption highlights are being shared, scorecard, and, you know, looking forward activities. So that's this is just a summary of this. And based on the involvement or, you know, people who are in that call, we may go into details of this success plan as well, which will include objectives, timelines of various objectives, and, you know, account scorecard, you know, in thorough details. So the process is, you know, before 30 day, we schedule a review meeting. On the day, we conduct a 45 one-hour EBR meeting, send a thank you email, assign actionable tasks, you know, 2 days later. So, you know, this is not exactly scripted, but we are moving into a more automated system where we'll, you know, a lot of these notifications and tasks will get created. Right now, we use a tool called HubSpot, which allows us to create a lot of workflows and tasks and assignments. And because it's a, you know, end of the day, account management is part of sales and revenue team. So, you know, HubSpot to manage a lot of the account management task and activity works well. So we use a combination of HubSpot and Google Docs together here. We are exploring, you know, more cheaper options than HubSpot, by the way. That's a different activity. The participants of this EBR are account manager, customer success manager, exec sponsor at your side, at the company side, and the leaders. And from the customer side, again, that's a typo, adoption champion and the exec sponsor. So we try to get the exec sponsor involved in these executive business review meetings. And for the same reason, we don't do these very often. For strategic customers, we do quarterly. For standard, semi-annually. And for small, you know, annually would do. Small for us are like, you know, small support clients who have probably, you know, around 200 to 400 hours of total support bucket, prepaid bucket with us. Strategy could be, you know, a large project like, you know, Legacy or Red Hat or, you know, in, you know, six to seven figures in terms of, you know, overall value for that year. And besides this, the execs at our company side do check-ins with the president or, you know, the exec decision makers at the customer side based on, you know, different cadence levels. So it's strategic, you know, we try to do monthly. With standard, we try to do quarterly or by on demand. So, you know, if there's a problem or a challenge, you know, we need the involvement of one of my president or directors who is a sponsor on that project. You know, he can just call the other guy and talk about it. And usually, you know, simple questions like, hey, how are things? You know, are we doing things the right way? You know, is there anything that you want to bring to our notice? Most of the times, you know, other than some major challenges that have been faced in the previous quarter or recent days, it's like, you know, it's a positive call between the execs. These are the objectives, right? So uncover latent challenges in strategic accounts, maintain exec level rapport with customer. This works very well because, I mean, you know, it's also like, you know, the good cop, bad cop thing at times. So, you know, the account manager and customer success, I mean, if things are going bad, then they would like someone way senior up from their side to speak to, you know, one of our senior folks and get it sorted. And then if it's a discussion at that level, you know, we change the strategy and, you know, we just say, okay, I mean, let's look at the importance of this account, the value that we achieve, are expecting to achieve, and let's make that happen. Invest if we need to do that for that as well. And then we track these because what we've done is we've actually built some extra bridges between the execs of both the companies. So we try to track that relationship as well, you know, whether those same people in our customer side are still working with them, have they changed? So, you know, following Twitter and LinkedIn and, you know, a few online channels and also getting inputs from the check-in calls with the product owner or the mid-level manager. You know, we try to see if those people are still there. If they have moved, well, who's the new person? And, you know, let's get him roped in this relationship as well. Due to lack of not having this activity, in the past we've lost accounts where, you know, the middle-level managers have been working together, but the senior people have been speaking to competition or there were challenges that they felt were not being managed well by us. And subsequently, you know, one fine day they'll simply move away. And then, you know, when you get to a renewal meeting, then you realize, but it's too late to be able to solve that problem now. So that exact check-in is very important. And if someone, a sponsor at the customer level has changed, you know, trying to get on a call with him or, you know, even travel to his office. You know, we have an office in Atlanta, Georgia, and we deal mostly with US clients. So, you know, we can even travel to their office and, you know, meet and greet and try to rebuild that relationship with the new sponsor. Explain to him the entire process, you know, what are the various checkpoints that we have and how do we want to achieve that. So, and then, you know, skip level meetings, that's an internal activity. Trying to avoid the manager at Axelerant. So, you know, account manager would directly have a call with the entire team on that account and saying, you know, try to understand if things are okay, if there's anything that needs to be done, just to build a rapport with the team. That's an internal monthly activity. Then we have risk meetings. In the interest of time, I'll try to skip this. The eight risks that I showed you when I started the artifacts, you know, those people, those owners of those risks, you know, we have meetings with those people. And then that's where we actually tell them, I mean, these are the risks that, you know, you are a CFO, but you need to work actively on this thing. And I mean, that's not the language, but we check the status of, you know, the risk there. Very often they may not be cognizant of those risks as well. So this is when you actually raise this risk to those senior people at your company level. A few slides about the way we run customer surveys. So we use Net Promoter Score. I'm sure a lot of you know what Net Promoter Score is. It's a standard way of capturing, you know, customer satisfaction. A scale of 0 to 10, which is 11 points. You know, we haven't automated this yet. It's a manually exercise, but we're planning to automate this to three levels. So send this question to the client. You know, he'd often tell you whether he wants to recommend you to a friend or a coworker or not. Based on his response, you can ask him you know, yes, no, I mean, why, what can we do? And subsequently, you know, make decisions based on that. The way NPS works is from 0 to 6 are called promoters. These are loyal customers and great source of referrals. 7 to 8 are passive, satisfied with the service, and 9 to 10 are detractors, unhappy customers. They can damage your brand. A score of greater than 50 is excellent, you know. But obviously, we also have negative scores. We also send customer happiness surveys on a regular basis, almost like at the end of sprints or on a monthly basis, in a set of fields in the form. This is one way of calculating CHI, so satisfaction score plus loyalty percentile within your organization plus propensity to recommend by NPS can, you know, give you one number. I mean, we don't calculate it via this score, but this was an interesting formula I came across recently. Hopefully, we'll be working on this thing. And last is advocacy, which is, you know, all the adoption activities plus you know, renewal negotiation meetings, referral programs, incentivized in terms of it could be anything that works for your industry or your customer. You could give him, you know, if it's a support account, you can give him probably, you know, another $100, 100 hours extra for the next year or something like that. Invite customer to key events, you know, ask them to speak, be your brand ambassador if they can, because you've taken them, you've elevated that relationship from a standard account, you know, customer to a more, you know, advocate ambassador level. So these people speak about you. Some of the matrices are these. You can pick and choose, you know, what works for you. The categories are leading indicators of renewals, leading indicators of expansion, of new business, retention, and cost metrics. Again, a combination of SaaS and services. For us, these are important. So lifetime value, customer acquisition cost. This comes from marketing. Customer churn, you know, how many of them are leaving you. Customer service satisfaction rating and NPS. Some visuals to, you know, plot those matrices to help you make some intelligent decisions. This is, you know, a chart showing how NPS changes with the customer tenure. Apologies for the quality of that image. This shows you the NPS versus revenue. So from this you can see service B, which is giving you more revenue, you thought so, but it's not so service A is giving a lesser revenue from promoters. So maybe, you know, you need to focus on service B more. Now that you've classified your customers, you can focus on the tiers, and, you know, based on that, you can make decisions. So just one, you know, visual chart to depict that. So yeah, with that, I mean, you know, I'm at the end of my presentation. These are some of the recommended ratings and credits. Customer Success by Nick Mehta. It's a good book. Nick Mehta is, I think, the CEO of a company called Gainsight. We follow their philosophy and practices a lot. Key Account Management, Definitive Guide by Malcolm McDonald and Diana Woodburn. And The Challenger Sale, How to Take Control of the Customer Conversation by Matthew Dixon. A few online references, you know, the blogs at Gainsight, Help Scout, and Zendesk are fairly interesting, especially when we talk about customer success and, you know, evangelizing, account management, you know, thinking about doing that shift from revenue to a more customer success focused way. We did took questions in the towards the start of the session, but I'd be happy to take more, you know, questions here or at the party at 6.
All right. First, thank you for the really informative presentation. I have a question about how do you close the scope gap when you do the sales handoff process in the sales handoff meeting? How do you handle the scope changes or scope creeps from an account management perspective?
So, the account management is not really involved so much during the scope creep because, you know, we have a defined change management process, and that's what we share with the client during the kickoff meeting as well. So, you know, this is how we are going to manage scope on this project. It also depends on the development methodology, right? So if it's, you know, what sort of a contract have you had with the client, right? If it's a sprint-based SOW, you know, you'll be probably signing a new SOW every time. So anything that is a new scope for this sprint, we'll go to the next sprint, and then, you know, you'll have a new SOW there. In support or TNM engagements, I mean, there's nothing called scope creep, right? So it's all about, you know, you get paid for what you, you know, work for the client. So what if, I mean, as long as the new requirement falls within the scope of what you do, I mean, you know, what you offer, you'll be fine doing that. And yeah, I mean, so we follow the regular change management processes from, you know, based on ITIL and PMI from a project management perspective. But if there are challenges from a scope perspective, you know, the risk, the 8 risks that I showed you will have a red color indicating that there is a challenge from this account. The customer is asking for this feature, but it's not within the budget or scope. So the respective owner is, you know, asked to manage that. If it's a big scope change, if it's a small, you know, we have a process defined for that anyways. Hope that answers your question to some extent. Okay. Any other questions? Yeah. Sure.
Yeah, this is about how much time and how many clients can you handle as an accountant, because you have a lot of steps and there's a lot of process. So
yes. So yeah, that's a very.
It
very
seems to me that there's a lot of work involved. In
yes, I agree. See, that's why, you know, this division of customers based on tiers helps. So, you know, if I'm spending, from an account management perspective, if I'm spending maybe, you know, 4 hours a week on every customer, you know, I need 10 account managers. So that's where we define, you know, only strategic accounts are where we're going to invest so much of money, so much of time, which is money, obviously, and diligence on the different tier, you know, lesser and the third tier, probably automate most of stuff. So, you know, the check-ins are fine. You know, we may just email them the reports and that should be fine. You know, just an annual EBR, exec business review for those people would suffice. And second is, you know, we're trying to move more into automating all of this as well. In SaaS, they call this tech touch. So you have high touch, low touch, and tech touch, if you divide them into three tiers. So that's something works well for us. And HubSpot has also been a great solution here. You know, it has helped us doing a lot of follow-ups and a lot of activities which otherwise we would have been doing manually. So yeah, operation efficiency is something we have been constantly working on.
But do you have like a number of?
Sorry.
Do you have like a number of accounts that a person can handle?
I mean, typically a single account manager should be able to manage, you know, anything between 10 to 15 accounts, I would say. Yeah, a combination. And, you know, there are, so I'm also an account manager, right? I'm handling some of the key accounts, so strategic accounts, right? So I mean, we don't have like 15 strategic accounts. We have 5 or 6, which are good enough for us on a yearly basis, I mean, as of now. And because I'm spending a whole lot of time with these accounts, more than, you know, a typical account manager would be doing, I obviously can manage only 5 or 4 for that matter. Yeah. Yeah, and later, you know, there's a concept called key account management, which is like, you know, more detail, you know, you actually invest, a lot of investments go into managing those accounts, you know, even people are working with the client at the client side, you know, so that level of detailing, yeah. And that's on a global level as well. So again, global was one of the parameters when segregating the accounts. All right, any more questions? All right, thank you so much.